Combination of various pharmaceutical agents, devices, etc. is helpful to manage these cases. Now, as we all know, in small pupil cases, the risk of every complication is increased because you write from the capsular excess, which is being done here exactly at the margin of the pupil. So your risk of having a nucleus drop, a PC rent or vitreous prolapse, etc. increases in these cases. The one thing that must be done in all these cases is to do a slow motion phaco using low parameters, etc. so that your viscoelastic stays in the anterior chamber. It also helps to maintain dilatation of the pupil. And do not try to struggle in a pupil as small as this, because that will increase the chances of complications. So now this is a clip which shows viscomitriasis using Helon 5. When you have high viscosity viscoelastics, viscomitriasis helps in pupillary dilatation, but as the viscoelastic is washed out of the anterior chamber, the pupil tends to become smaller again. So once the pupil becomes small, at this stage, stop again, replenish the viscoelastic, and this will help to inject the pupil, to enlarge the pupil, and always use a low bottle height so that you have low flow, low parameters, and the anterior chamber, there is not much turbulence, and the viscoelastic is stays in the anterior chamber, maintaining some degree of viscomitriasis. And do a slow motion phacoemulsification, and always remember to remove all that viscoelastic from, especially from under the IOL, because these are high viscosity viscoelastics, which are greater propensity for IOP rays. Another device is Mulligan ring, which is very useful, popularized by Boris Mulligan, and it comes with its own injector. It comes in two sizes, 6 and 7 millimeters, and it has these four scrolls, which can be used to enlarge the pupil. It can be inserted through the main incision itself. You don't have to make an additional incision. The three scrolls are engaged in the iris margin, and this provides a uniform dilatation with protection of the iris border for 360 degrees. Now, you have to go through a side port incision and use a second instrument, and especially the sub-incisional scroll is the one that is more difficult to engage into the iris. The good thing is the dilatation is uniform, there is no change during the surgery, and the iris border is also protected. Once you have this pupillary dilatation, you can do phacoemulsification exactly as the as any routine case. Okay, I'll go a little faster because of in the interest of time. Now, always be very careful that we don't have don't put stress on in these cases on the zonules, because already our surgery is compromised, and if there is a problem with the zonules, then it will be very difficult to visualize all that. And then in all these cases, we would have used viscoelastic very generously. So remove that viscoelastic at the end of the procedure. Should I go to the video so that I can go faster?
Go ahead.
Okay.
Take your time.
Okay. Okay. We have time till 2:35. Okay. I'll finish much faster than that. And so like I said, remove the viscoelastic, especially from under the IOL. Use low parameters. Use a reduced bottle height. And ensure that you don't place any stress on the zonular complex. And then the removal is also equally important. So removal is through the same injector. You have to first free the scrolls from the iris margin, because during the surgery, the iris would have become edematous and thicker. So there have been reports that if you do not, you're not careful while removing these scrolls and pull on them, there have been reports of iris tear also. So you free the scrolls, bring out the device into the anterior chamber, then engage one of the scrolls in this injector, which comes with the Mulligan ring itself. And once you've engaged one scroll, you can fold that Mulligan ring within the injector, and this comes out through the main incision. So the advantages, no additional incisions, a uniform dilatation and protection of the iris border for 360 degrees. Then the next device that can be used are iris retractors, which have been available for quite some time. And these iris retractors are hooks with a stop, so that you can pull the iris with a hook and then position the stop such that you have the desired dilatation or enlargement of the pupil. And we use four hooks. The disadvantage is you have to make four additional paracentesis incisions. And most people now prefer the diamond configuration rather than rhomboid, because this diamond configuration with inferior retractor provides you greater space inferiorly, where most of your phaco movements take place. The thing is that these iris hooks can come off during surgery. They tend to slip off, so we must minimize globe rotation, because when you have globe rotation, the chances of the iris hook slipping off are more. If they do slip off, however, you can put them again, taking care not to catch the capsular excess margin, because now you have a excess margin as well. And then this is the IOL that is being implanted with the iris hooks in place. You can remove two iris hooks for doing bimanual IA. Now here, this is a thick fibrotic iridis post-uveitic, and the pupillary stretch technique is not popular now because it has been shown that it releases prostaglandins and that causes problems. So we don't want to use it frequently, but it still has a place in selected cases of post-uveitic thick fibrotic irides where you can use the pupillary stretch technique using two Kuglin hooks or similar instrument. And increase your force very gradually, because if you suddenly pull, then the chances of iris tear, even zonular damage, has been reported. And it is a good idea to achieve some degree of dilatation using the pupillary stretch technique and then potentiate this enlargement using viscomidriasis after the pupillary stretch. And then this is a thick fibrotic irides. The capsules often in these cases are also thick, friable and fibrotic. So it is normally good to use a pupillary a capsule staining device, though here the surgery is being done without staining. So also remember that this pupillary stretch should never be used in cases of small pupil because of floppy iris syndrome, because if you stretch the pupil in floppy iris syndrome, it will make the iris even more floppy, which will tend to prolapse out of the incisions. So the other thing is the pharmaceutical agents. So intracameral preservative-free lignocaine does cause pupillary dilatation, as Dr. Pandey had shown. And a solution called epi-sugarcane is quite popular in some countries where you have a mixture of intracameral lidocaine and adrenaline, which is used to maintain pupillary dilatation, especially in cases where the pupil constricts during the surgery. So I'll stop this video here because we are running short of time. You can use a combination of techniques, like here, this is a posterior synecia, so you use synecholysis. You may even have to cut these synecia with Vana scissors sometimes if the synecia do not release with simple synecholysis, and then use your pharmaceutical agents like adrenaline, etc., as well as viscomidriasis. This is an eye ring which is now available similar to Mulligan ring, but it is not freely available yet and it is not used in India. But there will be more instruments available in the future. So to summarize, identify the potential problem cases preoperatively so that you are better prepared. Like for example, you can use a block in these cases because the timing of surgery may increase. You have your rings, pupillary expansion devices, etc. ready. Use techniques and devices. Do gentle slow motion phaco. And in the end, most important, do the surgery that you are comfortable doing, whether it is phaco, SICS or ECC. Thank you.